If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump, for the first 29 minutes, me, Adam, and Justin have some interesting conversation regarding on its new Star Wars kettlebell. Is it a
Had to clarify what I said on
follow-up
on
Adam's post.
Right, everybody got butt hurt.
Yeah, because he said it was a bad idea. Then we talk about Melissa's contest prep. This is somebody that Adam has been coaching and utilizing the MAPS aesthetic program with. She won first place, killed everybody. They're all dead.
That's how we
won. Tonya Harding method, right?
Yeah. Then Adam talks about his first competition, and there's a little backstory. He got some insider info.
Yeah, Doug, don't forget to edit that piece.
Make sure you edit out the person's name that he used. We did mention the Organifi green juice when we were talking about Melissa. She did use it to help her get with her prep for her contest. By the way, if you go to OrganifiShop.com, enter the code MindPump for 20% off. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, what do each of us do post-workout to cool down? What are our favorite methods and recovery aids? The next question is, how do we go about talking to our family about healthy eating and how food affects you? This is a very difficult topic. My entire family thinks I'm extremely annoying. The next question was,
I can't see why.
Do we believe that someone with a poor relationship to exercise and food can ever rectify those issues? Is there hope? We think so.
Yes.
And finally, if you miss a workout, is it a good idea to go extra hard and long in the next workout?
Whoa.
Said that little weird
thing. Yeah, very excited.
And also, you won't want to miss in this episode, the best analogy
it was like
Justin has ever made in his entire life.
Yeah, it was like Nostradamus meets Confucius.
I tell you
very
what,
much
if anybody can figure it out, we're giving away a t-shirt.
We'll give you if you can figure out what he was trying to say, we'll give you a
free water
t-shirt.
Versus ramp, I'm telling you.
That's it.
Brilliant.
Also, this month, enroll in any MAPS program or MAPS bundle and get MAPS Prime for free. MAPS Prime has fortification workouts that are correctional. It also has a self-assessment tool in there called a compass that teaches you how to prime your workouts properly. That comes with all of the MAPS programs that you get, so you basically get it for free. If you get the Super Bundle, which is 1 year's worth of exercise programming, you'll get Prime Pro for free, which that already has Prime, so you get everything. And if you get the Prime and Prime Pro bundle, then we'll just give you MAPS Performance for free. So basically, everybody gets something for free. You can find it all at mindpumpmedia.com.
Wee! T-shirt time! It is time for t-shirts, guys.
Thanks, Adam.
All right.
Hello, guys.
Give away, Doug.
What do we got?
All right. We got 7 reviews.
What?
Whoa.
Yeah,
that's like an all-time low right there.
I mean, it's a lucky number, but anyway. It's pathetic.
Can I tell people how to leave a review?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
All right, cool. If I can say it.
What's going on right now?
I don't know. This is what you do. You go to your podcast app, click on it, go to the search function, enter Mind Pump. Even if you're subscribed, you got to do this. Click on the icon, then you can leave a review. And you'll probably win a t-shirt if it's a good one and we like it.
Hmm.
Thanks, Doug.
All right. So we're giving away 2 t-shirts. The first one to ZStan80. The second one to Spreading the CrossFit Gospel.
Whoa.
Both of you are winners.
They gave us a 5-star?
Yeah. Yes, indeed. So send the name I just read to iTunes at mindpumpmedia.com. Send your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
Even though I flirt with lines like that, I never want to hurt the brand of the company, right? And someone made a statement like, you know, the Mind Pump team is always really known as a class act. I can't believe that you...
Oh, he did that.
Yeah, so so I had to come at him, you know what I'm saying? But do it really well because I was like, no. No one's using any exclamation marks. I love On It. I think it's a great company. I'm just being very straightforward. I could be wrong, you know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not saying that. It's just my opinion, you know? I'm a guy. And you know what? Here's the deal. Like, been in this industry for fucking 16 plus years. And, you know, we have lived and breathed like almost every aspect of it in a sense, whether it be someone that we've connected to, worked for, worked with. And so I feel like I have a pretty good pulse of the industry. And when I see something like that, I see licensing fees, I see molding, and then I see how well are the brands either or are the brands conflicting, synergistic, or neither, right? And I see that, and I and what my brain the way it works, like,
I see dollar sign, dollar sign, dollar sign.
And then I see how high, and then I see okay, well, what does it fall under? It falls under a tool, right? And as a tool, how many tools do you know that you purchased because it was cool or sexy? Normally, you make a purchase for a tool because it's functional, useful, practical, or affordable. So when you look at weights in that way, to and I'm not saying that because I think it looks fucking cool.
Yeah,
it looks fucking cool. No,
well, and I think too, you know, along those lines, I feel like, you know, I see that too. I see all the dollar signs and like what it takes to even like, you know, like are people even going to use them? You know, what's the purpose? All that kind of stuff. And then you think about like what it's going to do for unconventional tools. Right. So along that end of it, it's like, OK, well, this will get a lot of exposure to, you know, more of the mass public where they wouldn't have been drawn to it before. So I mean,
so you said that. So I asked this and I genuinely want you to hear what you say right here. Like, do you think somebody who's never lifted weights but is a Star Wars fan buys that, and that's what gets them to start using kettlebells or start
that's,
working
that's
out?
That's kind of a far-fetched.
Here's right. Don't you think that's a reach? Yeah. Like, you're the market. Like, no. You're the market.
Yeah, the market for it is people who are really into kettlebells who also are really into Star Wars.
That's
your market.
No, I don't even. I think it's even smaller than that because I think if you're really into kettlebells, you want a kettlebell.
You're not going to Comic Con and buying a kettlebell,
right? Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and you know, there's some hybrids like myself, you know what I mean?
Right?
And like you know, some other people that contributed, and I was like, yeah, you know, just because we're suckers.
Well,
we're suckers for merchandise like that.
You have disposable income. You have disposable income.
I'd love to know the numbers and see how.
Yeah, me too. I could be totally wrong. Like, I could be totally wrong.
Like the Captain America plates and all that stuff. Like, I wonder.
And I don't know. I don't know Aubrey's personal relationship with any of those companies. So for all I know, he's got an incredible.
Oh, I'm sure he just got a licensing deal through Disney. I mean, Disney owns both those brands, and it was like a business deal where it was like, okay, we have like a certain licensing agreement, so you can either use these with apparel or you can use these with equipment.
Right.
And so then he's like trying to like make something of that, you know?
And that's what I'm wondering, like what that licensing deal looks like. And if you're talking about Disney, you ain't talking about
expensive.
You're not. Yeah. Like when Nintendo did that with Vans, like I would be interested to see what that number looks like. And I'm sure
it'd be a good person to ask. Like I have a kind of a relationship with the founder of Santa Cruz brand.
Yeah, I bet he would know.
So they did. I mean, that's like all their whole business now. But they honestly only used the shirts and apparel and all that, which blew my mind. Because you think of Santa Cruz, you think of the apparel, but they only use that to sell trucks, and they're all about the boards and the trucks, like the hardware. That was just something that happened in excess, but like kind of that's what everybody knows the brand for, all this stuff.
You got to ask yourself, they've done it before with the branding, with other things that weren't licensed, but that was their own thing. But they did the Captain America plate. That was licensed. So I'm sure they looked back and said,
yeah, but was that
we're not losing money. Maybe it's not a big money maker, but maybe it's just part of the branding.
Yeah, but the way
you know what I'm saying?
The way I would think the licensing would work is it's up to Onnit to create whatever it is. I'm paying for the license.
Yeah.
So I think this is more about I made a business decision to license with this brand.
No, that's exactly
and
what
I'm
it is.
Scrambling with ideas. I've made shirts, I've done kettlebells, I've done weights.
Well, because I posted too. Look on my Instagram, like there's skate decks that one of my client has that you know have the Star Wars images on it, and to be able to get that done, like those were the ones that they didn't approve of. So their brand is the one that comes up with the designs, and then they get it approved by you know this licensing sort of agreement council or whoever's in charge of that side of the business,
right?
And then you know, you have to present them with your ideas, your art, all that stuff, and then they approve it.
And you're already probably paid out.
So you're paying for all that process. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. So you got to look at all that, and then you got to ask yourself.
So you this might be just that we got to squeeze out stuff.
Right. Because it might be we decided to do a deal with these people.
It's not turning out. So let's just get everything.
So let's do whatever we want. And the reason why I challenge that, and that's my thought process on all this, is because I mean, have you seen a Captain America plate or a gorilla or anything like that besides Joe Rogan using the gorilla kettlebells?
I'd love to see the numbers. I'd be interested in that.
Oh, I would love to see it.
Though, see, this is what I'm thinking is there's definitely things that people who are into working out or hardcore into working out that they would buy that look cool. And it's usually not, it would usually be a throwback to the weights, the culture of weights or the culture of barbells. Like, in other words, I could see an old-timey barbell being sold to to gyms and shit because they want it in
their gym. Novelty, but it's functional still.
Yeah, like the one Eugene Sandow is holding.
That would be super cool.
That's something that I could see, but to have it kind of branded.
And even then, I think that would be hard, right? I think even
that's still very small.
Oh, yeah, it's a very niche.
Although that would be sick. Imagine having a row of those barbells.
Again, going back to what is a barbell, what is a dumbbell, what is this? This equipment, these are tools.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when in tools, like, this is something that you want to see a progression in. You want to see them as they evolve, they get more functional, they get better, and they get cheaper.
Well, and I'll be honest, this is what I went through with Axon the whole time I was trying to design it. It's like, it screamed lightsaber, you know, and everybody told me that. Like, it's going to be like, you push it down, I see lights, it's lightsaber, you know, and like, oh, and let's cloud it so it even make it kind of look like it. I'm like, I have to establish the fact of its relevance and it being a tool. Like, if it's a tool, I want it to be more familiar to the gym setting and like what people will expect as they go to reach for something to use, right?
Right.
It's going to lie besides all these other like tools, and it serves a function and a purpose. And so also I want to convey the importance of that type of training in general, which gets no notoriety or publicity. It's not popular, you know? So it has a long road ahead of it, you know? And so like it has to be established as a tool and serve a purpose and all that kind of stuff. And then, you know, down the road or whatever, like I could see like kids or something, but like even then that's such, if you're trying to market to kids, good luck.
Yeah. And it's not something you can use.
Yeah. What, a $250 kettlebell for a kid? Like no kid's going to play.
Well, not only that, but you can't use it. I mean, we haven't even said that. I think we're assuming people know that, but you can't use a kettlebell with edges on it and stuff. You can't rack it, 'cause you're going to fuck your shit up. You can't, I mean, swinging it, the weight is a different distribution. Yeah. They're totally non-functional. Yeah. So anytime you have a kettlebell
design. I'm sure it's designed, I would hope, it's designed to be balanced at least.
Well, it'd be balanced left to right, but the weight, the shape of it's different.
It's just not ideal. No, yeah, it's right? Not. So right, it like right. rubs you, like, right. oh shit, like, yeah.
No, I've try racking. Played around with you ain't going to rack a kettlebell with a big iron face.
All of it can be done and whatever. It's not a matter of could it. It's just, it's not functional. It's not ideal. And when you're a tool. So that was like my whole thing. I think,
that makes sense.
For the most part, I think some people got where I was going with that. I know it was definitely not a personal jab on it. I would just be curious to see. There has to be market research on this. I mean, if I had to guess, I would guess that they have probably somewhere between 50,000 to 100,000 consistent customers. Out of those 50,000 to 100,000 consistent customers, probably 25,000 to 30,000 of them are like regular buyers of supplements, apparel, and whatever else all the other good stuff they offered through on it. And then my guess would be, okay, how many of those are actually using unconventional tools? And then I would send out a market research to all those people asking them, hey, if we did this, how many would pay extra money for this and see, get a good idea of like where, if that would even make any sense. But I think it's a reach to get more people that aren't into lifting weights.
Yeah, they just want a cool
and
thing.
I don't think that's this. I mean, how long have you been in fitness and before you even started using a kettlebell?
Well, kettlebells, I've been in fitness for a long time. They weren't around when I first started.
But they were, though, around.
They were in Russia.
I mean, they weren't. They were here.
They weren't. They weren't here. They weren't here. You couldn't. So the first kettlebells that I bought, I actually had to have imported from Russia. No joke. You couldn't find kettlebells here.
Yeah, I had to buy them like as I went through like some of the courses. Mm-hmm. Like that was the only place you could get them.
Yeah, it was definitely definitely hard to find. And again, another reason why I think this is crazy is like it is such a small niche market.
Yeah, it is.
It's already and we're close friends with, in my opinion, and that's not because I'm biased either, just because the Kettlebell Kings hands down is the best kettlebells in the game. Anybody who uses kettlebells or has used them or has done kettlebell sport will tell you that. Hands down, right? So, and there's a couple other brands that are pretty solid too.
Because they keep reiterating like the importance of, you know, the performance end of it. So they're asking athletes like, how big should our window be? How, you know, all these like performance driven design implements. And so they keep trying over and over to improve. So it's a different mentality than just trying to
sell.
It's
totally did. And so, and in your opinion, if both of them are racehorses, because we're talking about business right here, and we're talking about two businesses that are providing a similar thing.
Onnit's in the lead, but they're going to totally surpass them.
Especially in that department.
In a few years.
In that department,
100%, right? Yep. So, I mean, and I feel like a company that big, you have the money, you have the resources. I would have better spent it on either one, finding
like legit kettlebells.
Why would you not do that? I'd rather dominate I would either one try and look into a company, which by the way is in the same city as they are, acquiring them or partnering with them, or that's who I would partner with. I would choose to partner with a legitimate kettlebell.
Mm-hmm. And get into the kettlebell sport, which they're not even part of sponsoring.
Right. So that's what I meant by the whole business thing. I don't think it was smart. It was a poor decision and totally not a knock on it whatsoever. I love the company and I love a hell of shit about what they're doing. Yeah. This is one of the things I don't. And so I was just voicing that. I was curious to hear.
Yeah, they're heavy on the cool factor.
Yeah, I want to see what other people think. And you know, everybody had to say it was cool. Mm-hmm. But I'm like, dude, I want to know how many people would actually buy this thing.
Cool doesn't always work.
Yeah, how many people would actually cough up fucking $250 bucks, dude?
Yeah, that is expensive. You mean put that price out there? I was like, ooh, yeah,
dude,
that hurts.
Right, for one, you don't even get the other Vader. you're doing is single arm work. You can't even do two arm
lateral training for the next 5 months.
I don't think anybody's buying those to use them. I don't think anybody's buying those for workouts.
Yeah, I don't think
it's 100%. It's cool.
It's funny.
It's a lot of money. They're not trying to sell a lot of volume.
You know what's funny? We might actually buy them. You know what I'm saying? Because I could totally see having them in our studio because of the fact
that I got a Vader bank there.
I can't
help it.
I know. I would totally get one for Justin as a gift, you know, because
I'd like paint it. And I would love it.
So, dude, we got to talk about Melissa's competition, dude. How well she did.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
She fucking killed it.
Yeah. First and second, man.
So first in the overall novice, is that what she got?
So yeah, she got first in the overall novice. First, so if you got first in novice, that puts her in the category to compete against the overall novice, which means all height category. So novice, she competed in the category against all girls that they were competing their first show. She smoked that. She won not only her height category, which there was 12 or 15 girls in that one. I think that one had 12. That one had 12. The other one had 15 girls. She takes first place in that, and then she goes competes the overall, which now she has to win against all the first place girls that are in different height categories. Won that, and then the open, which pretty much puts her against anyone who's been you could have been done 20 shows under your belt. Mm-hmm. So it's anyone and everyone that's competing there that's just still an amateur, and she took second in that. And
had she been more well known, I bet she would have got first.
Oh, that or even. You know, just you could tell first time show, she had her nerves. I could see she was, you know, so the only time that really in the novice, I thought she smoked everybody, not only her physique, but then even her composure and stuff.
So here's what I want, what I like, what I found fascinating about this, because she's not a huge girl. She got shredded. Mm. Kudos to her, but also kudos to you, Adam, for training her. I know you were taking her through. Yeah. Like MAPS aesthetic type training.
MAPS aesthetic, it works.
And the nutrition advice that we tend to give people. Up until her contest, what was her daily calorie intake?
She was over. Well, I brought her all the way up to 2,400 calories, and then I slowly, over the course of the 9 weeks, took her down to 1,600.
1,600 calories was her pre-contest. That was her nutrition. And that's a full 600 calories more than most
girls. Yeah, and she's only 100. You gotta remember, she's only 112. She had staged at 111 pounds.
See,
so she's little.
And that's just like proper training, proper signaling, anabolic, kept her muscle.
Can't actually keep eating.
Got lean, didn't damage her metabolism. I mean, the proof is in the pudding.
It was for me. It was very easy, and I'll be very truthful about this. One, she had a great solid base. I knew that when I met her. I saw her physique. She's been weight training for years, so she had good balance. I've told people on this show before, I can look at someone's physique, and I could tell you if you were built to compete. She was built to compete.
Yeah, we saw the mechanics as she was doing some modeling stuff for us beforehand. We're like, wow.
Yeah.
You know, like somebody that's trained, you know, for a good amount of time looks like that.
She squats. She deadlifts, so I know she got a great base on her. You're right. Her mechanics were nice and she's pretty. So she would look great on a magazine when she's all shredded. So I knew she had the potential to do that. And she's a very smart woman. So I knew teaching her would be easy, and she want, and the only thing that she wanted from me was that that was the deal. Was she came to me and said, "Listen, I've never wanted to compete before. I've been, you know, listening to Mind Pump. I've heard you talk about, you know, competing and the way you're approached." And she's like, "I have so many friends that compete, and I have no desire to do that. And I think it's so unhealthy and it's wrong for the body. But hearing you talk about it, like, it makes me want to try and do it the right way. Do you think I can?" And I said, "Yeah, no, I absolutely think you can." And so that was kind of the deal. And I said, "Okay, well, what I want to do is I want to document it and everything while we do it, because this could be something that later on the road we use for advertising and marketing and stuff." And I thought she's a perfect girl to do that with. And so that was the agreement, was I'm going to coach you through this process, and we can use your photos and images and everything like that to share with people to market any of our programs. And so she's like, "Right on." And so we started along, and I told her before we picked the show that I wanted to have her for about a month or so I can kind of see where her calories were. And I wanted to push her calories up as high as I could before I took her the other direction. And I think this is a mistake that a lot of people make when they get into dieting for a show, or just dieting in general. They don't find kind of where their baseline is. They just all of a sudden follow this super low calorie restricted diet. And I wanted to see where she was at. And she's got a lot of good lean mass on her. So I slowly took her, and when we took her diet the first week, she was about 1,800 calories or so, 1,700 to 1,800 calories. And so over the course of a month, I creeped her up to about 2,200 calories.
This is hilarious. She hit contest eating almost as many calories as she was normally before you started working with her.
Mm-hmm.
That's and I say that's ridiculous. It's awesome, but it's just, people need to know you can do it the right way. This is incredible.
She didn't run on a treadmill until 2 weeks out either. Was the first time she ever.
She was shredded.
Yeah,
before she got ripped.
So it also made it very easy for us to reverse out, because we didn't overdo anything.
So now you're following like a MAPS aesthetic, but obviously individualized for her, because you're training her.
Well, we actually followed MAPS aesthetic to a T all the way until...
Like literally the programming that's there.
Yeah, literally to a T. In fact, that's how I started her, was like I sent her everything and said, I want you to follow this to a T. As we get closer and I start looking at your body, I'm going to modify and adjust your volume according.
What were the focus sessions on for her?
For her, hamstrings and shoulders.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, hamstrings and shoulders. And I told the reason why that was I said, these are your, in my opinion, these are your money muscles for women's bikini and men's physique. Not men's physique, not the hamstrings, but the back more so. Because it's what exaggerates that V taper. So building good shoulder caps on her. It brings her arms together. Always makes arms look great. So even if you don't have the greatest arms, if you have great shoulders, mm-hmm. It makes you look like you have great arms. So having great shoulder caps, and I said that'll make your V taper be wider, and it'll really bring your arms together. So that was an area of focus. And she has really good legs. She just needed to put more focus on her hamstrings. She's very quad dominant. So we laid off a lot of squats, and that was a small modification too in MAPS aesthetic, is I pulled out a lot of quad dominant movements, and any leg exercises I had her doing, they were more hamstring mm-hmm. focused. So I had a lot of sumo deads in there and stiff legged deadlifts. I started focusing more on the posterior chain. So that was the main modification. And I just, over time, I progressed her volume faster than it's organized in the MAPS Black program. So in the MAPS Black, we basically want you to go all the way through around before you start building upon that.
Sure.
With
but
her,
she was starting out at a higher level.
Right. She was already at a higher level. And plus, again, we have a time that we're working mm-hmm. on. So this mm-hmm. is how I'm going to scale her up.
You think that she got like the itch to compete and keep going forward with this? Or is she kind of just like...
100% she's addicted now, right? Yeah. And because especially
well,
since
bro,
she won.
She's got
she
pro...
Won.
She, that doesn't
yeah,
pro
I mean, she won like right out of the gates. But I just remember her kind of like going into this with hesitance a little bit, because you know, wasn't like super into doing this to begin with, and was trying to kind of more make a point of like, this is how you can do it the right way and healthy, all this kind of stuff.
And it's funny because her and I really didn't spend a lot of time talking about this, because I never wanted to be influencing her either way. Like, I didn't want my experience to be her experience. I wanted her to have her own experience with this. I just gave her a little bit of foresight on some things to look for in the industry, what to expect with judging. So when I didn't ever tell her, even though in the back of my head I had high expectations for her placing, I knew that it could go any direction with the judging and stuff. And so I made her know that listen, you know, I don't have like a great name in bodybuilding. You know, people might know me a little bit.
Yeah, you know,
I don't tell
them Adam sent you.
Yeah. Like and that's actually why if you actually look at her Instagram and stuff like that, she's not repping me at all. I didn't want her to. I said, you know, I don't think you should. Like, I honestly have been out of the circuit for over 2 years, and I don't know how the company feels about me, because I've openly shared a lot about competing, and I'm obviously not a huge advocate, even though I did it, right? So she kept it really quiet, just referred to me as coach all the time, but never really talked about me personally.
Now, you said you had talked to some of the judges or something over there.
Oh, God.
About the whole thing?
You want to get into that?
Yeah, I don't know. Ooh. I mean, do you?
Was it juicy?
No, it was. So you guys have heard me share the story about my very first show and my placing.
Yeah.
Do you remember what I told you guys? I don't know if you guys remember this. So, and this is important to get this, because this is a crazy part about the story is, I went to take Melissa backstage, and one of my buddies, he's worked for Muscle Sport for a very long time, which is one of there's two main companies, Spectrum Fitness, Muscle Sport, that host all these big shows. And he's worked for them for over 4 years. Well, he's working the show, and I find out the day before, so I call him up, my buddy Raj, and I get backstage, and they see me walking in. I'm carrying one of the cameras. And she's got her bag, and I got no bracelet. And they're like, hey, you can't come in here. And you definitely can't come in here with that camera. And I'm like, oh, I'm not shooting the camera. I'm like, it's all good and stuff like that. And I see my boy Raj like across the room. And I'm like, yeah, no, I'll just wait here. And I made eye contact, and he came over. And as soon as they saw me talking to him, they kind of left me alone for a little bit. So he introduces me to one of the main guys, and he's also one of the head judges, right? And he walks up to him, and he goes, hey, bro, this is Adam Schaefer. Do you remember him? And he's like, he's looking at me like he doesn't remember me at all. And he starts like talking all about Mind Pump. And
oh, no.
And, oh, yeah. Totally embarrassing. This guy's got like 30 plus years on me. So he's an older guy. And my buddy's like name dropping me and talking about YouTube and Facebook and Instagram. And it's all social media stuff. This guy's like fucking, come on. This guy probably doesn't even know how to turn on a podcast, right? Yeah. So I'm feeling embarrassed for him, because my buddy keeps like, I can't believe you don't know him. He was a pro. He's this. He's telling him all that stuff to him. I'm like, oh, God, dude, just it's no big deal. He doesn't know who I am, right?
Yeah.
But I know what he was trying to do. He was trying to get me a wristband for free so I could hang out in the back, because no one's supposed to be back there except for people that are working and all the competitors. So we end up like kind of chopping it up, lied about the show a little bit, and then he walks away and he snaps his fingers and he goes, I know who you are. He's like, Adam Schaefer. Oh my God, dude, I judged your first show and I judged your USAs. He goes, boy. And then he starts talking about one of the other judges, one of the head judges. He goes, she sure didn't like you. And he tells me the whole backstory on this day. So if you remember the story, I told you guys, I came out on stage, and this is the only time I've ever seen this happen, is it happened to me, where in pre-judging, you pretty much know what place you're going to get. And so I come out on stage, and in the morning show, these guys don't even call me in the first lineups. So that means I'm taking sixth place or worse. Now, why that was a big deal to me was, this is the show I tell you guys that when I unzipped backstage, literally all the
what are you doing?
All the fittest dudes awesome. Walked over to me are like, who are you? Who's your coach? Oh my God, asking me all these questions. I hope I get second to you. Like, already everyone conceded. I hadn't even hit stage yet. All the competitors in the back already tell me. So, of course, I went out there super confident. I felt good. Hitting stage, all my competitors telling me how great I look. Get out there. Don't even get first call-outs. I'm standing next to the guy that's at fourth and fifth, and I'm looking at him, and I'm like, dude, it's not even close. And so I'm pissed, but I'm trying not to. You can't act like that because you're trying to smile. You're supposed to be all whatever. So I leave that night, and I talk to my buddy Raj, who works. I'm like, dude, what the fuck? He's like, dude, I don't know what happened. That's crazy. I don't know. So this guy tells me. So let me explain how judging works. You've got your five judges. Out of the five judges, you have one head judge. The head judge decides who the first five are out. And then the rest of those judges say, oh, he's first, he's second, he's third. And then they look at everyone's scoring together.
It's not like a dog show.
Right.
Yeah.
So they do this, but so that day, every other judge either placed me, and he tells me all this. He's like, every judge placed you first place or second in the entire show.
Oh, wow.
The head judge didn't even put you in top five.
So what was her deal?
She said during the break, they got into a fight about me. And so he said they were going back and forth and they were arguing. And she's like, this is too much. We have to stop it somewhere. He's way too ripped. He's too muscular. And so that was.
You got dinged for it.
So yeah. So she was, we need to make a statement. And they're all like, you can't. This is not fair. Like, this guy looks great. Da, 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 da. And they're going, and then they're all fighting for my case. And so the compromise was they bumped me to fourth place, which keeps me from competing at nationals. You have to get top three to get qualified for nationals.
Was this your very first show?
Very first show.
Yeah, I was there.
Yeah.
I remember that. I was like, what the fuck? How? There's no way.
Yes.
Yeah.
So So he told me all the backstory of that, and I've never heard that before. Of course, I've told the story on Mind Pump before, yeah. And I'd shared all that, but to actually hear, and then he told me, then he remembered USA's. He's like, oh man, that was you and Devin Lennon. He even told me the reason why I didn't win then. He's like, you know, they came down to all the judges. It was one other judge and me, and we were going back and forth. He liked Devin because he liked a little bit harder look. I liked you, skin complexion, everything was so much better, but you guys were neck and neck. I said, no, him and I got flip-flopped like 10 times. I've never seen that happen before. So yeah, he put it all together, and then we ended up chopping it up forever. He gave me a pass. We're hanging out back there.
That's some bullshit.
But what a crazy
God, that world is so funny.
I know,
right? Yeah, yeah. I mean, but it just shows you like that's how this shit works, right? Like, I mean, you know, people talk all the time.
There's no metrics.
There isn't. Yeah, there is. Yeah. It's so
nothing.
It's so objective.
Subjective.
And all it takes is one person like that to not like you, especially if it's the head judge, because they dictate who comes out in that top five.
You can never compete again after Mind Pump.
Right. So I told Melissa, don't tell them who you're with. Just go up there and go do your thing, right? Yeah. No, she absolutely
smart,
killed it and looked awesome. Super, super proud.
Did it all the right way. Good strength, good performance.
I definitely I had a lot of people inbox me that actually would love to hear her get interviewed by us. So maybe we'll have
We'll do that.
Yeah, maybe we'll have her come on.
I know people are going to ask, and I know she had worked out a small sponsorship through Organifi. What supplements did she use? Did she use any of them consistently up until the contest?
The only things that she was using was the green juices and the occasional protein shake.
Okay.
And that was it.
What did she like? What was it about the green juice? Because you're obviously coaching her. You can see changes or whatever.
Well, the way I told her to intermittently put it in there is the same way that I use it. Is and I know this from competing too, like sometimes when you're making food in bulk, like making vegetables in bulk kind of sucks sometimes. Like nothing's grosser than 2-day-old freaking asparagus or whatever like that. Like, and you don't need to be that miserable.
Day of, you want to make it. Yeah.
Right. So I told her, like, so if there's days where you can't get enough of your greens or what that, and you know you're not getting it at every one of your meals, you know, that's where you use it and supplement it. And so, you know, she was consistent with that. Yeah, we used that all the way till towards the end, because once again, I'm pulling all.
You want to pull anything that's you don't know.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. So anything I'm not 100% sure exactly to the calorie, what it is, and the sodium and stuff like that, we're manipulating at the end. So, and that was an additional 25 calories. So at that point, we were down to counting every calorie too. Mm-hmm. So,
well, good deal.
Yeah, it was cool.
Bring the bird.
This Quah is brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
Our first question is from Life of Symmetry. What's each one of your favorite post-workout cool-down methods and recovery aids?
Not a protein shake.
Okay, a favorite post, because I'm gonna say I definitely don't have a ritual that I do here, because
I wash my groin.
Yeah, that's smart.
I know I can give you some recovery aids tools that I use. Like, I love cryotherapy. I just fell off the ladder, and I've been dealing with swelling.
No. He literally fell off a ladder.
Yeah. Yes. This isn't a metaphor.
Yeah, he's not making a metaphor. He was on a ladder.
At the very top, and he fell.
And he fell.
And I really
fucked,
slow.
I it fucked was like, myself up. That's why I'm dwindling away right now, for those that are noticing. Like, it's been 2 weeks since I've lifted. So I've been using the cryotherapy, and God, I feel amazing every time I get out of there. You can with something like that where I have an acute injury, you can see the swelling come down. Like I walk in, my back is all swollen. There's like a lump, and then you go in there and it's like all the way gone.
I'm going to be honest. Like, watching really big dudes fall is fucking hilarious.
Like, did you see him go down though?
Yeah. It was like,
fuck you, bro.
It took so long, dude. Like, all of his limbs are up in the air and they're like huge.
Oh, you know? Hold on. You saw him go down.
Yes, I was on the other side.
Everybody
couldn't do anything about it.
Three guys there, nobody holds the ladder.
I would have tried to catch him or something.
I missed it. I missed the whole fucking thing.
You fucking let that happen. It was so slow. You could have caught him.
And everybody who should have seen that.
You know the worst part about that is as a child growing up, I worked around my dad was in construction my whole life, so I literally have been around ladders and climbing ladders my whole life, and like there's just rules to like when you're working. Like, you know, always have somebody who holds, like, that's like in safety 101 totally. For like every, anyone who's ever worked around.
Especially a sketchy ladder like that one.
Well, especially when you're and it says don't ever stand on the very top,
the green part.
Don't stand on the top. Always have someone hold the ladder. Neither one of those I was doing while I was balancing a fucking 90 pound.
You're a rule breaker.
You know what it might be, because you guys know I've been doing a lot of meditating stuff. Maybe the universe gave you karma for that time you yanked me with the fucking band and made me fall. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that was a mean ass karma get back there.
Wow. Well, you know, karma doesn't.
You didn't even like.
Karma doesn't care. You know what I mean? Mm. Karma doesn't care. Karma. No, I got a scratch on my knee when I fell. So you cryo sometimes?
So I use cryo.
Have you tried it before?
Yeah. Awesome.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
I remember
it's
you
like
saying
a supercharger.
That.
Yes.
Yeah, I've done
yes.
that.
Yes. Before it's awesome. After it's awesome. So if you want to talk about tools that I consistently use, I would have to say that in the as far as a recovery tool, that one would be up there. I've dabbled in all kinds of stuff, but that's a go-to. Mm. I feel really good. Now the downfall of that is cryo is really expensive, so it's not even like a really good deal. I think is either a monthly membership, like a tanning salon, which is a pretty heavy commitment for some people, and per visit can be pretty expensive, but. You know, normally that's how it works, right? The shit that works really well or that's really good is not cheap. And so it's not a gimmick. It very much so works. It very much so helps. And it's definitely up there with my favorite tools.
I would wonder if the cold from the cryo post-workout, obviously reduce inflammation, probably accelerate recovery. Would it or could it potentially also blunt the muscle building signal?
I would think
like
so.
Like we're finding with other things that tend to damp down inflammation.
Yeah, when you think so, like you'd want to do that intermittently. So at least then you also like get the benefits of the inflammation.
Yeah, because then you have the other side of that too, which is if I'm able to control inflammation with this tool, then I can work out harder. So maybe that offsets, you know what I mean? The reduction or whatever. It'd be an interesting thing to see because right now the research is so mixed as to whether or not, you know, now research on anti-inflammatory drugs is pretty clear. You take them a lot, especially around your workouts, and you will build less muscle and dampen that muscle building signal.
And I feel like
that's
taking something like that, and you would know this better than me, if it seems more like that would be something that would block a signal versus something that would, like a cooling down process would be something that would speed up that signal or process. Like,
here's what I'm thinking, because they've had some studies that point to how you may have lowered protein synthesis responses if you do something like an ice bath. This is cryo is different because it's so quick, so I'm not sure if it would be the same thing. But you know, inflammation is an important signal. It tells your body to send resources to rebuild and strengthen. And so,
right.
But inflammation run amok is bad. That's horrible too. So it's kind of like this balancing game. You know
I feel like the way I use it right now is like Because
you don't use it at right every workout.
Oh, right. Oh, yeah, God knows. No, no, definitely not. Not even close to that. I don't even think I use it once a week. It's very intermittently. Mm-hmm. But if there's anything that I consistently do, that's probably as far as a recovery tool or aid.
Yeah.
That's probably the one that I probably go to the most. But even then, I don't do it that often. And the way I do it is like, okay, I fell off a ladder. So that's obvious, right?
Yeah.
So,
yeah,
I
mean,
that's a no-brainer why I'm going to go in there, because I'm not worried about building muscle in that situation. But, you know, we admit on this show, and I'll be the first to admit it again, that I flirt with the boundaries of what I should be pushing my body and I shouldn't be pushing my body, and I most certainly overdo.
Right, and you know, like, yeah. I think that's the determiner for me. It was always like using recovery aids. Like, I know that, oh my God, I just blasted myself on something I haven't done for very long.
Right.
And so it's like, oh shit, I know that I'm going to get a lot of damage, you know, from this day because I overdid it.
Right.
So now I'm going to look towards recovery aids, you know, with that mindset.
And that's just forward thinking, because you know, if you don't, the next day you're going to be so hindered, you may not even work out again or whatever.
Terrible.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. So there's a couple things that I do pretty regularly after my workouts that I've noticed good benefit from in terms of both recovery and improved muscle adaptation or signaling. One is I do a combination at the end of my workout. If I have time, I do this after every workout. I do a combination of deep static stretching with tension positions and movements and maybe foam rolling.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in MAPS Prime, we actually put that in there.
Yep.
We talk a lot about MAPS Prime doing, you know, priming your workouts, but what we don't mention a lot of is we also teach you how to post-prime, which is also
solidifying the strongest, you know, the best pathway for a lot of, you know, your recruitment process.
Like, exactly.
We really wanted to put that in there.
Exactly.
Because, you know, we teach your body to do it, then we go through the, you know, actual workout of it, but let's really hone in on you know, what we want.
Yeah, so to give you an example, if I have if I need more range of motion and I have just excessively tight hamstrings, I'll do some static hamstring stretches at the end of my workout. This is when static stretches are great, by the way, because you're warm, muscles are pliable, you can get more range of motion. If the hamstrings are just super, super tight, then I'll focus on stretching them at the end of my workout. But then I'll also connect to the hamstrings at the end of the stretches so that I make sure that I can connect with new ranges of motion that I created. Foam rolling is really good for tight, what we would call overactive muscles. That's a bad name, but these are foam muscles that are very, very tight that are getting in the way of certain things, so like my piriformis.
Mm-hmm.
I may foam roll my teres major, minor. I may foam roll. And then I may do some tension movements at the end to solidify the signal. Like Justin said, this whole process takes me 10 to 15 minutes at most. And then the other thing I used to love to do, I don't do so much anymore because I work out so early in the morning, is I love to go for a walk outside in the sun with my shirt off. I have a theory that the sunlight stimulating, you know, the use of, you know, cholesterol to form vitamin D is giving me kind of this post-workout anabolic effect.
Hmm.
And I used to always feel my best after my workout when I was able to do that. I'd go for like a 30-minute walk, get some sun exposure, and I used to feel really, really good afterwards. And the guys, you know, and I got this idea.
I wonder if it has something to do with the kryptonite crystals.
Yeah, exactly. And you know what gave me the idea of why this may be beneficial is the bodybuilders of the 70s, especially the guys that worked out in Venice.
Out in the sun all the time.
This was part of their formula. And yeah. Arnold had actually written some article saying how he thought it made him feel, you know, better afterwards. So, Justin, what do you do?
Yeah. I mean,
rub one out.
Yeah, it's my go-to. It's just like straight to whacking it. I mean a lot like you guys. Like, you do cryo sometimes, so I'll do typically I'll just run like a really, really cold shower as a nice recovery, like in stimulating kind of it keeps me too. I find a lot of times when I work out like super hard and I have an intense session, like the rest of my day I'm more on the groggy side, so I'm less like charged up if I like just barely kind of overdo it. So that's when I know, okay, I need some recovery aid. And so this is one of those where it's like, okay, I get like re-stimulated by going through like the cold shower, and then also like, you know, the lower inflammatory kind of effect with that as well. But, you know, if I had access to cryo, I would be doing it more for sure.
Right.
But yeah, so that, and then, you know, like Sal mentioned, like I do a lot of those moves as well, especially the, you know, spending the time to, open up my hips. That's been a big thing for me, and just solidifying that position. So I'll add tension like 90-90, and you know, also in a kneeling position, and then adding, you know, this anterior line that I'm establishing and opening myself up. So that's really helped me because of all the driving I do all the time, all the sitting I do here, like, you know, all that kind of shit really like adds up in my hips. So yeah, that's kind of like my go-to. And then, you know, like as far as eating goes, like I'm not trying to hit a window or anything like that, but if I feel hungry, like I'm going to go get something to eat. Like, you know, that's my thing.
That's your ritual.
Yeah.
Quick commercial break. Hey, people ask us all the time how they can support Mind Pump. Here's what you can do. You can go to www.brain.fm/mindpump and get 20% off Brain FM for meditation or focus. You can also go to audibletrial.com/mindpump and get a 30-day trial plus one free audiobook. Lastly, you can go to getnatureblend.com/mindpump and you will get a discount on Ben Greenfield's CBD product.
Next question is from Keto Carr. How do you go about trying to educate your family on healthy eating and how food affects you? Her grandfather has had 5 heart attacks over the course of his life, and after his most recent one, they went and ate at McDonald's.
Fuck. You know what? So this I got a story.
Yeah, I have one right in the same. I took McDonald's to this situation just like this.
Did you? No,
yeah,
so I got a story that's up. So she's talking about her grandfather. So a few years ago, or maybe I think it's been like 5 years now, I would go with a family member to visit to when she would get her chemotherapy. She was, you know, had been fighting cancer. And so you get to meet some people that come in and get their treatment and stuff. And then you talk to the nurses. And I was talking to one of the nurses and we were just telling stories. And she told me the story of this 94-year-old Italian man that came in there that they discovered had lung cancer. So the oncologist is like, look, you know, I don't know what to tell you. You've got lung, and he's a smoker. I've been smoking his whole life. He's like, you got lung cancer. So, and the guy's like, yeah, what's your point? And the guy goes, well, I mean, we could do all these treatments. And chemo goes, I'm 94 years old. I don't give a shit. And he says, she says he walked out and fucking lit up a cigarette. And it's like, you know, sometimes at that point, her grandfather may be in the state of mind where he's like, I've had 5. I'm old. Yeah. I don't give a shit. I'm going to do whatever I want. So that's what happens there. As far as the family is concerned, I annoy the fuck out of my family at this point. It's very, very difficult. I mean, my family will eat something and they'll look at me to see the look that I give them. And I have to be careful because I know I can be annoying. Like,
don't give them the people's eyebrow.
I'm really starting to annoy my parents. Like my parents, my dad is like, dude, seriously, you're getting my fucking nerves.
Is this like recently?
Because, you know, my parents are now, they're in their late 50s. They're relatively good health, but I can see how that's going to start changing if they don't start paying attention. Once you start to hit your 60s and stuff, you don't get away with nearly as much stuff. And for the most part, we're pretty healthy, but my dad will have these like organic like sodas or, you know, he'll have the occasional whatever, you know, ice cream or whatever. And he's had some issues with blood sugar. And so I'll like break his balls about it. And I'll be like, Dad, I swear to God, if you just ate like this for 1 month, I promise you, you'll never want to go back this and that. All you get, and I'll set my mom, this is what you're going to do. This is the food you're going to eat. And then she'll be like, well, your dad won't eat that. And then my dad will be like, well, she won't make it for me. And they'll go back and forth.
Yeah. It's this argument.
And I fucking irritate everybody. And then I go to my mom's house and I open the cupboard and I pull out the snacks. I'm like, Ma, why are you buying this? This one has the highest rates of glyphosates. And she's like, but you said that it would be good if it was this and that. So I got the wrong one again. And I'm just busting everybody's balls. So
yeah,
very difficult with your family. I think the best thing to do is.
Dude, it was so funny. I was drinking some of our, just the green juice. Like, and I was like hanging out and my parents were coming to pick the kids up. They wanted to take them somewhere. And I'm just sitting there and my dad's like, ugh, what is that?
Yeah, it's green.
Like, yeah, it's just like, it's green. And he's like, ooh, like I was trying to describe to him, like, well, this would actually be something good for you, you know, like easy because, you know, you don't even eat vegetables or enough to begin with because you're like a little kid, you know, and I like called him out and he, like, I've never done that, but he's my dad, you know, but I'm like, I swear to God, I'm like challenging him like so hard. I'm like frustrated with it.
You know, it's funny. So my best friend Justin, his dad is like cigarettes, right? He does like a pack a day. And You know, my other buddy, his parents are, you know, overweight. And then I have my mom and her eating habits and stuff. And so I feel like we're all kind of at this age where, so, I mean, I've been in fitness for 16 years plus now. And, you know, when I was in my 20s, like, I didn't really bother them. Like, I was eating kind of whatever I wanted, training, working out. But now that I've gotten older and I realize, like, and I got autoimmune issues and I can see the difference in what a low day, high day looks like. I mean, life changes after 30, right? And but I made that connection right away, like how important like the food, the exercise and everything was. And I feel like they haven't, because they're still stuck in that, like, they think they're good because they don't know what their own body feels like great. And it's just like, I want to show them, like, I want to show you what great feels like. Like, it's not that hard. You just got to get, and once you get there, it's not hard to convince you to stay there, because you'll always want to return to that feeling because you've felt how your sleep was, your sex drive was, your hair, your skin, like, all of it gets better.
Yeah.
And
they
so
just don't even know. Like, yeah, I haven't even been there yet.
Well, and I think all of us probably gave up about 10 years ago. And then why I feel like we're all revisiting it now is, you know, because we know they're getting older. And now it's actually a thought that, like, fuck, you know, like, I know some people that
preservation here.
There's a lot of people that have died in their early 60s.
All their friends, like, and it's just like,
fucked up.
I'm serious. I'm like, dude, don't you see? Like, I'm like, take this seriously, you know? But it's like, you can't, like,
it's you know what we should do? You know what we should do?
What?
This might be the thing. Here's the problem, 100%. The hardest people ever convince to do anything are the people that know you the most or know you the closest. Like, it's very difficult for me to sell anything to my parents, but I can do it to your parents. Yeah. So maybe what we should do is, like, I should hang out with your mom and your dad and you guys.
That is brilliant.
And we'll fucking close each other's families, because my
dude, like, I gave him our fasting guide and all that kind of stuff like a long time ago. I'm just, look at it. It's really easy. Yeah, it's, you know what I'm saying? And he passes it along. His friend is like raving, like, wow, this is so great, life changing, blah, blah, blah. He's like getting all these massive, like, crazy results. My dad's like relaying this, like, you did a great job, like, you know, you guys really put something cool together here. Why aren't you using it, man? You know what I mean?
And it's like, now when I go to eat dinner somewhere, people have to make I become like the jerk, you know? My mom's like, well, I couldn't get this, whatever, you're not gonna like what you're making. And I'm like, all right, I can see I'm getting on everybody's nerves. Very difficult thing to do. Just the best thing
nature
you could,
the beast.
The best thing you could possibly do. Only thing that I've ever done that works.
Live it through your life.
That's it. Yeah. Is just be the example, and then they will ask you when they're ready, or they'll start to change how they eat when they're ready, and that's it. And then the other thing is, when you have them over your house, feed them the way you want to fucking feed them.
Right.
Like, my parents come to my house, guess what you're gonna eat tonight? Some healthy, organic, low starch, low sugar.
And that's how Katrina and are the same way too. Like, if we're preparing dinner, if you're eating with us, like, we're eating the way we eat, and it is what it is. And we'll even go to the lengths when we actually come over a lot of times, because, you know, her and I will just bring our food. It's just, we've gotten to the point where it's like, hey, we're not going to tell you guys how to eat. That's fine. Like, that's, it's your life. And I'm definitely not one to say that anymore. Like, we've already gone there. Like, you know, I'm here. You know, I can help you. You know, if you have questions, I'll always answer. But if I'm going to come over and you want us to be all family and eat all the time, like, we do that a lot in her family. I'm like, I can't do that every week. And it'd be like, you know, garlic bread and pastas and desserts. And, like, I mean, I love all that shit, but I can't. Yeah. So
it doesn't love you back.
I can't, you know, you can't get offended if I decide to bring our dish over here and eat it with you guys, because I want to enjoy the family time too. I'm not going to eat this food, you know?
Next question is from Jess G. Veggie. Do you believe someone with a poor relationship with food and exercise can ever completely rectify their issue? Or, in your experience, are these issues going to be a lifelong struggle?
Is it possible? Yeah, absolutely. It's possible to do a lot of things that people fail to do because they're very difficult. So when you develop a poor relationship with food and exercise, in reality, it's an image issue with yourself. You've identified with something, you feel a certain way about yourself, and that now has been connected to exercise and nutrition, and you've developed these, it's like muscle recruitment patterns. You've developed these thinking patterns, the way you see something. The reason why when people go on spiritual quests or do things and have breakthroughs, the breakthrough is usually in something that that's always been in front of them. They just weren't able to see a particular way.
Right.
Like, I you know, I've talked to friends. Yeah. I'll tell you what, my divorce was one of them. I mean, while I was in the end of my, you know, my marriage or the last 5 years or whatever, I didn't think I was doing anything wrong. After you're out of it, I had the fucking, like, brilliant realization that some of the stuff she was telling me that I was doing wrong was very, very true. It was always in front of me. I just failed to change my filter and not identify with, at the time, what was that I was a victim 100% and I wasn't contributing to whatever the problems were. So you have to be able to reach that point. You have to be able to look at everything from a completely different standpoint, which means how you feel about yourself has to change. You almost have to shed your skin. Right. And, you know, one of the ways you do this is you change all your habits. If you have a poor relationship to food and you do all this tracking or you have a poor relationship to exercise and you run 5 miles every day, shift it completely. You might have to go through a period where you don't track at all and be okay with the fact that you may gain weight or lose weight or whatever, because you got to go through that process. Mm-hmm. Your fear of losing weight or gaining weight, believe it or not, is going to prevent you from breaking these chains. And the same thing with exercise. Like, one of the instrumental things I did with changing my relationship to exercise was when I started doing Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Before going to Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, all my entire focus for my workouts was getting bigger. It was always getting bigger. More size, more muscle. That was it. That was all that was important. I like to be strong and big, and that was it. I could care less about anything else. When I started Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, in Jiu-Jitsu, technique is extremely important. Mobility, flexibility is extremely important. So stamina, which are somewhat conflicting with the extreme goals of building muscle. And so when I started doing jiu-jitsu, I'm a competitive person. I wanted to do well. I enjoyed it. It allowed me to change the focus of my training to the point where I only lifted weights about 2 days a week, and it was zero muscle building focus. It was all about improving my jiu-jitsu. And I did that for about 4 or 5 years, and that really gave me a different perspective to when I revisited exercise.
I think you make
I had a completely different.
Yeah, you make a good point that I see, like, you really need a radical paradigm shifting moment to happen and occur. And I don't necessarily know that I would have the answer for that for each individual, right? Like, that looks so different, like, on so many different levels, like, of, you know, how you can sort of awaken and you know, like, think differently. Like, you have to do something where you completely think differently for you to shift and see new perspective. And I think that these require that, because otherwise they will follow you. They'll follow you. It's going to be a constant struggle because it's, you know, you're sort of fighting a game of push-pull.
Those moments, but also I want to say real quick, it's still a process. It's like you have a moment, you're like, well, boom.
I think 100% it can rectify the issue. I think it will forever be with you, right? I think things that have formed us and shaped us into who we are will always make us. Like, I think, you know, Sal and I talk a lot on the show about us both having the insecurity of wanting to be bigger. And I think that memory of that feeling is forever with me, and it makes me into the man I am today, but I'm fully aware of that now. And it directs me with what I say and how I act and in the future, right? So I think that somebody who has had a really bad, poor relationship with food for a really long time, like Justin says, I do think that at one point, I think you need some sort of a paradigm shattering moment or something that's happened in your life that really transforms the way you're thinking, whether that be an outside source of somebody influencing you or a scenario that you go through in your life, but something that's transformative and causes you to think differently about about your life.
Absolutely. I think when you're this transformative moment, this moment where you got this kind of like glimpse of clarity, like, I need to fix this, doesn't mean something has to happen. It can literally be you just sitting there and then saying to yourself, like, I got like
acting this, on the thought.
Yeah, yeah, like I need, like, this is a big deal and I need to fix this. And in order for me to fix this,
it takes action, whether, you know, whatever it is, it's going to take action.
That's the moment. The moment right there. Like, the moment for me with the exercise was when I said, fuck, I don't care if I get smaller. I just want to get better at jiu-jitsu. That was it. Like, that was the big moment where I could finally kind of change my relationship to exercise. It is a process. Just like it was a process for you to develop a poor relationship, you know, you didn't instantly have these patterns of eating and patterns of exercise. They were rooted in something, usually an insecurity of some type, or poor self-image or whatever. But over time, you developed these patterns where this is what I do. I restrict my food this way, or I track this way, or when I'm stressed out and anxious, I find comfort in eating these foods, or I overwork out and I train this particular way. Like, you've now developed those patterns. Just like when you train your body, it takes a second to identify the pattern and change how you approach them, and then develop new patterns. And that's why it's a process, because I had the realizations that I need to fix these things and I'm going to work on them way before I got to the point where it's become a natural practice. Like, I knew I had to work with food for myself and become more intuitive with my nutrition, but it's been a process of years in the making, to where, you know, and I still think there's more to do. Same thing with exercise. So I definitely think, and by the way, studies will show that people that believe they can change do change. People who don't believe that they can change almost never do. Nothing ever happens. You have to believe it as well. So the answer to this question is yes, you can rectify this issue. Believe it.
Quick commercial break, you guys. We keep getting asked all the time, how can I support the Mind Pump family? Here's one of the best ways you guys can. You guys love that Chimera coffee that we have. Chimera coffee with a K. You go to chimeracoffee.com, put in the discount code MINDPUMP for 10% at the checkout. If you guys have not tried Ben Greenfield's new bars out, they're fantastic. If you want some, go to bengreenfieldfitness.com/naturebite, put in the code MINDPUMP and get 10% off. Go check it out.
The next question is from B2 the IGB. If you miss a workout, is it a good idea to go extra hard or long next workout to make up for it, or just continue with your normal routine?
This is a good question.
B2 the IGB.
This is a good question, because I feel like there's a common theme in fitness with this, where, you know, we eat all good all week. And then Friday comes along.
Trying to make up for it.
Right, yeah. We party hard all night long, stay out late, don't sleep well. Saturday, you wake
up. It's the whole earn your calories kind of mentality.
Yeah, and you get into this, kind of punishing yourself for missing the day before.
Oh, yeah. Didn't even look at that angle, yep.
Yeah, so I see, or at least personally, this is in my experience, so maybe the boys have a different one. I used to see clients do this a lot, you know, and I'd have to stop them from doing this, because they would be like, oh, I didn't get my workout in yesterday. I was supposed to, so I'm going to run, 5 miles today, or I'm going to do this, or I skipped breakfast and I did that. You know, it's like they start to almost punish themselves from what happened the day before. And I think getting people to understand that, you know, a single workout, the amount of fat or muscle that's built in that single one workout is so, so tiny and minimal that it's not even worth stressing.
And then all that extra punishment is going to, like, cause an effect the next workout. You're going to have, you know, not that great of a workout if you're, like, overly sore and you've overly worked your muscles.
No, if you're pretty consistent with your workouts, you know, you work out 4 days a week and, I missed one, trying to make up for it with the next workout by either making it harder or longer not only won't make up for it, but it will probably be a detriment, because now, like Justin is saying, you've applied more volume and more intensity, probably more than your body would need at that particular moment. It's not like you can't add them all up. You know what I mean? I can't say I have 10 points to earn and then so I can do them all in one workout and it's going to be the same thing. It doesn't really work like that with exercise.
Not only that, on that point, this is also how I advise somebody who's getting back into the routine, because how many people fall off for 5 or 7 days, or fall off for 14 days, or fall off for 27 days? The further you fall off, or that you have not been back to the gym, the less intense the workout.
Yeah, now
look.
You got to start a couple steps back.
Right.
In fact, even missing one workout will affect you a little bit. And so having that extra hard workout is not a good idea. And lastly, sometimes, many times, actually most times, missing one workout if you're normally very consistent might be a good thing.
Yeah, more often than not.
A lot of times people get back in the gym, get back to working
out. I think that's where our advice would be different on each person, right? Like if I'm talking to somebody who I know is consistent all the time, like they follow it to a T, they're 4 days a week, and they just want to know, like, hey, I missed Monday, you know, what should I do now when I go in on Wednesday because I missed that workout? Well, if you're consistent with 4 days a week all the time, don't worry about it. Yeah, I mean, that was probably good. It was probably better for you is the advice I give. Now, if this is somebody who can't seem to get consistent and they haven't strung 2 weeks in a row of working out consistently and they now missed another day and now they're wondering, well, should I do extra hard because I missed a day? Well, no. Again, your volume of training shouldn't even be that high. And the further and the more days you have missed, the less intense the return workout should look like, which is the opposite, I think, that most people approach It's, you know, day one, motivated.
Smash hard.
Right, I'm motivated to get back. Well, if it's day fucking one and you haven't been in the gym for 27 days,
it's going to hurt that much.
Yeah, it's like, go do one set of everything and get the fuck out of there because everything you do is going to send a new signal because you haven't been sending that signal for the last 27 days.
So. I'm trying to find an analogy for this, but I feel like it's almost like pouring water, you know, and like letting it like gradually float and rise the level versus like I'm trying to like go for this sort of graph that's like, well, if it's this, I need to ramp up and everything's ramping up, you know, it's like it's going to take a while for everything to kind of settle. Like you have to like just be consistent with it, right? Does that work?
No.
I was like I'm trying to picture this.
Damn it. I feel like it was working.
I was trying. I was like, fuck, how do I put this together? A ramp and water.
No. God, I'm really bad at analogies. It reminds me of like the gasoline one that I was trying to
throw out there a long time ago. That's my favorite. That's what
I wish you would do that more. Like the way I mess up on words, I wish because it's fun for you guys. I wish you would give it analogies.
I do like the angle that you went with this, Adam. No, not Justin.
Thanks.
I don't know what the fuck it was. I like the angle that you went, Adam, about punishing yourself because I didn't even think about that. This if you do this a lot, it actually sets the stage up for a bad relationship to exercise where I miss one and I punish myself with a harder workout the next time.
This is what I experienced.
That's what's common.
In my experience, this is what was common. Yeah. So, and this person could totally not be that person, but I had many, many clients that would do this. I mean, if we're being completely honest, we've said this before on the show that, you know, 20% of the people actually are successful, even the ones that hired great trainers like ourselves. Like just it requires follow through and execution on the other part. And a lot of people don't do that. They fall off all the time and they get into these terrible routines and habits. And this was a popular habit that I would see clients
do. It doesn't work.
Is they're very inconsistent and, you know, then they're on and then they're hammering themselves and then they're off and then they're hammering themselves. Yeah. And it's like constantly I'm punishing myself because I missed
off wagon.
Right. I missed my workout the other day.
No wagon.
It's like, yeah.
There you go.
That was it right there.
I had to make up for that.
There is no on or
off.
There is
no wagon.
There is no wagon.
Oh my God.
I said there. There it is. There's your moment.
There it is.
Check this out. Go to YouTube, Mind Pump TV. Subscribe to the channel because I told you so. Also, if you go to mindpumpmedia.com, we have 30 days of coaching. It's for free, and it's like water filling up gradually.
In a bucket. It's not a linear progression, okay, motherfuckers?
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic, 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.